The natural beauty of Alaska is stunning, with charming old town ports, gold rush history, fabulous snow-capped mountains, fjords with numerous glaciers, beautiful valleys, waterfalls, totem poles, and wildlife for the observant eye. We cruise through the Inside Passage and up to the Gulf of Alaska to the port of Whittier. Enjoy highlights of our cruise as we travel by boat, float plane, helicopter, and train to enjoy the beauty of Alaska. Starting in Vancouver, we travel up the Inside Passage to the Alaska Panhandle, with stops in Ketchikan, Juneau, and Skagway. We continue to Glacier Bay along the Gulf of Alaska to Hubbard Glacier, up to College Fjord and the port of Whittier. For thousands of years, indigenous peoples have lived in Alaska. Around 1740, Russian traders began to explore and occupy its coastal areas. British traders were also making their way across Canada and into the Northwest. In 1825, Russia and Britain agreed to boundaries which established the footprint of Alaska. After the Crimean War, Russia's economy struggled and their remote settlements were difficult to supply and defend. So Russia chose to sell the region to the U.S. rather than risk losing control of it to Britain. Alaska was sold in 1867 and it became the 49th U.S. state in 1959. I enjoyed our cruise to Alaska much more than expected. Its coastal scenery is fabulous, with many opportunities to spot wildlife, although you really need binoculars. Ports along the way are unique in character and the experiences they offer. We actually sailed both directions, visiting most ports twice for double the excursions. And with much of the cruise along the Inside Passage, it provided the calmest sailing we have experienced. And with any cruise, it's great to unpack once, eat all you want with a good variety of food, and enjoy the onboard entertainment. Reaching the southern entrance of Alaska, we arrive at Ketchikan. The indigenous Tlingit people are comprised of coastal tribes which occupied much of the entire Alaska Panhandle. They used the Ketchikan location as a summer fish camp, and today it has the world's largest collection of standing totem poles. Its Totem Heritage Center has 33 totem poles preserved and on display, along with other indigenous artifacts and artwork. Ketchikan has a thriving fishing industry and calls itself the salmon capital of the world. A must-see spot in town is Creek Street. Having its roots as a red light district, it is colorful, picturesque, and fun to stroll along its boardwalk. Boardwalk continues as Married Man's Trail, historically used by patrons of the brothels as a back door to the district. Today, the short trail continues along the Ketchikan Creek to a small salmon ladder. We did a boat excursion called Lighthouse, Totems, and Eagles, but we were disappointed and felt another tour would have been better. What you see here was captured with my long zoom lens. It was too far away to really appreciate. Families may enjoy the Great Alaskan Lumberjack Show, where they like to get the crowd cheering and can be heard around town. This is the tallest single-mast sailboat in the world. Notice the airplane on the back. For thousands of years, the Juneau area was also a popular fishing ground for the indigenous people. Then in 1880, the Tlingit chief showed two prospectors where to find gold at the mouth of a creek. Well, that started the Juneau Gold Rush, attracting many prospectors to the area, and the town gets its name from Joe Juneau, one of the two founding prospectors. It became the first American settlement founded in Alaska after it was purchased from Russia. Today, Juneau is the capital of Alaska and the only U.S. capital without a road connecting it to the rest of the state. The terrain behind the city is extremely rugged, largely being the massive Juneau ice field, which we will soon see. Primarily a government town, Juneau is not visually appealing, but has some great sights to explore. We enjoyed the Gold Belt Tram, conveniently located near the cruise ship port. The tram cars climb 1,800 feet in 6 minutes to an upper platform on Mount Roberts. And the trail on top leads to fabulous views of Gatineau Channel and the port below. A popular excursion in Juneau is the Mendehall Glacier, a short 12 miles from town. Near the visitor center is a photo point where we see the glacier in the distance along with Nugget Falls. The glacier flows down from the vast Juneau ice field into Mendehall Lake at its base. It is about 1.5 miles wide and is receding back 100 to 150 feet each year. We'll fly over it with our floatplane ride. An easy trail leads to the base of Nugget Falls, which takes about 20 minutes each way. Our tour included a visit to Gold Creek Salmon Bake. We enjoyed the ambience of its rustic setting and all-you-can-eat buffet. A short pleasant stroll along the creek reaches Salmon Falls. The Chilkoot Shaft was part of Wagner Mine, which was abandoned in 1930. It was one of many mines established during the Juneau Gold Rush. We treated ourselves to an exciting 40-minute flight over the vast Juneau ice field. Wings Airways has a set of 5 de Havilland Otter floatplanes with new 900 horsepower engines. The 5 Glacier Exploration Tour flies up along Mendehall Glacier, which we saw earlier. It continues across the ice field, looping around large glaciers on the east side, then down the Taku River back to Juneau. We loved it, and I was pleased the glass windows allowed for good video. The Juneau ice field is the 5th largest ice field in North America, and it is 1,500 square miles, stretching from the Taku River all the way to Skagway, straddling the border with Canada. 38 large glaciers flow from the ice field, and we get a close-up view of 5 of them from the air. Skagway was born with the Klondike Gold Rush between 1897 to 99, which caused a stampede of around 100,000 prospectors into Canada's Yukon Territory. The majority came through here, using one of two routes over the mountains, and they had to bring a year's worth of food to prevent starvation over the winter. Nearby was the Chilkoot Trail, over a mountain pass initially used by the indigenous Tlingit people, but the climb was steep, with pack animals unable to help. Up the valley from Skagway was the White Pass, promoted as doable for horses, but the animals were heavily weighed down and not always cared for. Often the trail was blocked by a fallen horse, and it earned the name Dead Horse Trail, with an estimate of 3,000 animals dying along the trail. For a time during the Gold Rush, Skagway was ruled by a con artist gangster called Soapy Smith, who even had the town's deputy marshal on his payroll. He and his gang conned many unsuspecting prospectors of their money and intimidated the community. He died in a shootout on the wharf, killed by Frank Reed, town surveyor and bartender, who also later died from wounds, becoming a local hero. Just out of town is the Gold Rush Cemetery. On the edge of the cemetery lies con man Jefferson Soapy Smith. The town wanted him behind bars. The largest monument is for hero Frank Reed. And a short, pleasant walk following a trail uphill brings us to Reed Falls. We take a scenic ride on the train from Skagway, traveling over the pass. Construction of the railway began in 1898 and was completed in 1900 to Whitehorse, ironically just as the Klondike Gold Rush was over. As we enjoy the scenic views, we can only imagine the stream of prospectors trudging along the valley and the terrible fate of so many horses. We get off at Fraser, BC, where the Canadian Border Services are located. Leaving the train, our tour now takes us by bus to the nearby Yukon Suspension Bridge. It's a scenic spot, with a walkway 57 feet above the Tuchi River. The small lakes we saw on the White Pass summit feed into this river, and its waters eventually reach the Great Yukon River, flowing past the Klondike Goldfields by Dawson City, continuing into Alaska and emptying into the Bering Sea. The lodge has a mammoth tooth, a tusk, and a bone on display, claiming to be found in the area. For more adventure, we ride a helicopter and walk on a glacier. At the end of Skagway's terminal is Temsco Helicopters. We flew to Mead Glacier on the northwest side of the Juneau ice field. Before we left, we put on rubber glacier boots to help us walk on the wet ice. And for safety, we stayed with our guides and did not wander off.
My goodness.
A short sail from Skagway is fabulous Glacier Bay. It's on the southern end of a snow-capped mountain range which dominates the coastline up to Whittier. All along the way are inlets or fjords with massive tidewater glaciers reaching down to the sea, and the views from the ship are incredible. I call the rest of our journey a sail through the land of glaciers. Notice the lines on the mountain, carved by an immense glacial sheet of ice. In 1794, Captain George Vancouver sailed here to find the ice extending all the way to the entrance of the bay. Glacier Bay is a national park and a World Heritage Site. A park ranger boards our ship and provides commentary along the way. Reed Glacier is about 3/4 of a mile wide at the waterline and 150 feet high. The Grand Pacific Glacier is 1.3 miles wide at the waterline and up to 160 feet high. It's over 20 miles long, flowing at a speed of about 1 foot per day. Its brown appearance is ground up rock and dirt blown down from the nearby mountains. Marjorie Glacier is beautiful. It's one of Alaska's most photographed sites and one of the most active. It is about 0.85 miles wide, with an icy face about 200 feet high. It flows at a quick 3 to 7 feet per day, with chunks falling into the water called calving. The ship stops here for a while, allowing us to observe its beauty, and if we're lucky, some calving activity.
Oh my!
Lamplu Glacier is 0.9 miles wide at its face and about 165 feet high. It flows up to 1 foot per day. John Hopkins Glacier is about 1 mile wide and up to 300 feet high at its face, with a quick flow rate between 5 to 12 feet per day. Most glaciers are retreating, but this one is one of the few that is advancing. Ships are not allowed to get any closer to protect harbor seals in the area. We leave the inside passage and sail up to Hubbard Glacier. About midway, we get a good view of Mount St. Elias. Those lucky passengers will get a close look at the glacier. That excursion was sold out by the time we booked our cruise. Hubbard Glacier is massive. It is North America's largest tidewater glacier, 7 miles wide and rising 350 feet above the waterline, and it has another 250 feet below the waterline. Hubbard Glacier is 76 miles long, originating from Mount Logan in Canada's Yukon Territory, which is the second tallest mountain in North America. Continuing up the coast, we enter Prince William Sound and sail into College Fjord. Along the way, we have a beautiful view of Mount St. Elias, the second highest mountain in the U.S. and Canada, as it straddles the border of both countries. The snow-covered St. Elias Mountains are the highest coastal mountain range on Earth. In 1899, just as the Klondike Gold Rush was winding down, an extensive exploration of the Alaskan coastline took place. Edward Harriman, an American business tycoon, embarked on a 2-month voyage with numerous scientists of various disciplines, along with writers, artists, photographers, and a couple college professors. They were the first explorers to enter College Fjord, and they named its glaciers after elite colleges, ignoring Princeton. Our cruise ship sails into it on the way up, providing a nice slow observation in and out. Harvard Glacier is the star of the show. It is the largest in College Fjord, being 1.5 miles wide and 300 feet thick at the waterline, and very active. We visited College Fjord twice. During our port stop in Whittier, we went back on a 26 glacier cruise by Phillips Cruises on a smaller boat which gets us much closer to the glacier. As we were approaching Harvard Glacier, it had just dropped a large iceberg off its face, causing large waves. That is when the excitement began.
150-foot splash right there. Just moving up so the Klondike, oh, there it goes.
On the way back to Whittier, we spot more wildlife. We wrap with a quick look at the Port of Whittier, gateway to beautiful Prince William Sound. Anchorage is another 60 miles away, accessed by a narrow tunnel at the end of this road, with alternating one-way traffic for vehicles and railway. Some cruise lines use Seward as a port, which is an additional 67 miles further south of here. We sailed both directions from Vancouver. Travelers who come up towards Anchorage choosing to sail in one direction have the option of including a multi-day land tour. With these, you fly in or out of Anchorage or Fairbanks with train or bus transport to lodge accommodations, usually Denali National Park. If you enjoy my videos, I encourage you to subscribe to my YouTube channel and click the bell to be notified of new releases. It's free, and sharing with your friends is much appreciated.